So hi again, everybody. My name is Gabriela Dow, and a lot of you know me from my time with Gov Partner, which I was a founding member of. It's an e-government firm that implements technology projects for cities throughout the country, and also a few projects now in the United Arab Emirates. Before that, I spent some time working in the news media at two CNN bureaus, at CBS here in Los Angeles, and then I also spent some time in Washington, D.C., working for the Clinton administration in the Office of Public Liaison and working for a governor in Washington, D.C. And now I do consulting. I live down in San Diego, and it's been an interesting convergence of all of this background experience that I have, because at the end of the day, I've always been passionate about government, whether I was covering it from the news media side or whether I was actually working within government. And I've always just been very curious and passionate about technology. And so my work today involves consulting with corporations that are, you know, international or national, and consulting with startups that might be a 25-year-old launching his or her first business, working with government agencies, which is always very interesting, and then with organizations like Startup Circle down in San Diego. So I'll be touching on some of these experiences. And it really has been very interesting over the last year, because I'm usually trying to get the government agencies to try something new, trying to get the startups to slow down for just a second, have at least one brand standard before you throw everything out there in front of the public, and trying to get the corporations to speed it up a little bit. They're willing to try new things, but it just takes a long time. And of course, the people that have the budgets don't quite have the curiosity to want to do interesting things with them, and the ones that don't have budgets are trying to do the most they can. So I kind of blend it all together. And so what I did for Vine, I'm going to do the presentation using the Vine platform, but my presentation is actually on who is our audience? Because we have a lot of presentations, and I think we've been exposed to a lot of the different platforms and a lot of the different tools that government uses to communicate. But who we are communicating with has really changed and is rapidly changing. And as I found doing some research for this presentation, who we are as communicators, whether individuals or government agencies, I believe is changing also. So I think this is going to be an interesting experience. Using Vine was a little bit disjointed, and I kind of purposely, I think it's going to have a little bit of a disjointed feel, but that's kind of the heart of this presentation, as you're going to see. So like Alan mentioned, I did my presentation last year using the Pinterest platform. So instead of PowerPoint slides, I decided to create a board. And so then my presentation was on public-private partnerships. And instead of slides, I just went to, you know, to different items on the board. And what ended up happening is there was a lot of coverage about the fact that I did a presentation about Pinterest. And so you can see here, this was an article that our friends back there did about Government 2.0, and it was really about my presentation about Pinterest. And so that was an interesting example of how the medium becomes the message. So even though I was talking about public-private partnerships, the message, because I did it through Pinterest, really became that it was a presentation about this particular medium. So that's what I want to explore today, is what does it mean, the fact that we're using internet-based and mobile technologies and medium, and how does that affect us and our audience? So as you can see here, I mentioned it was disjointed. You can't quite have it in order. I experienced the same thing with Vine. As I was finishing the presentation last night, tweaking a few things so that I could include some of the coverage that, of course, we were all watching from Boston, I actually had people commenting on my Vine and liking my Vine. And so that just, I think, really speaks to the experience today that it's all in real time. Usually you wouldn't want to be doing a presentation, especially one that's being live streamed to a global audience, without full control of what you're showing up there. I mean, somebody could post something that I don't want you all to see, but I think it's worth taking the risk. So hopefully we won't see any crazy comments. And that's the, I think that's the reality that local governments and government agencies of any kind live with as they start to explore putting themselves out on Facebook or other mediums. You're obviously seeking the exposure, and the gals from NASA showed us it's a great way to get exposure, but you are exposing yourself. And so you're putting yourself out there to potentially have a bad situation. Some of the technologies that I've been tracking, and I think we've all been seeing since last year, was obviously Pinterest continues to go strong, and it really shows how the medium is very visual now. One image really can tell the entire story that maybe a web post or an entire printed document would tell. Facebook's acquisition of Instagram, I think, was something that was very important last year. We have Waywire, which popped up there for a second. That's kind of a new version of a YouTube video control system, and Cory Booker, the mayor of Newark, is involved in that venture, so that makes it pretty interesting. Google Glass, I'm going to be talking about that throughout the presentation. And then Nextdoor has been mentioned already through some of the other presentations, where you have a platform where neighbors can get together, which is kind of sad in a way. It used to be the neighborhood block party, and now it's online, but government agencies are able to disseminate messages to specific neighborhoods, so I think that that's interesting. And then there are also payment processors, which I think are very important. This is kind of the behind the scenes evolution, but one in particular, Stripe, I think is very interesting. Some of the guys from Twitter have been involved in launching this particular venture, and it's just a very elegant design to make payment processing very simple and user-friendly for the developers themselves. And then, of course, I think a lot of us are familiar with Square and some of the other tools that are out there. So this presentation is influenced by a book, and I know that the author was already mentioned in another presentation, Nicholas Carr, of a book called The Shallows. And has anybody heard of this book or read it? Okay, so a few hands. This was recommended by my son's elementary school principal. And he recommended it because he wanted all of the parents and teachers to understand the way that our children's brains are being shaped in our own brains. And so, of course, I went to the library and I checked it out. And I started reading about how our brains are no longer able to focus and get through something like a book. And then I started to actually experience what I was reading about. As I was reading that we have this constant distraction from email and text messages and the need to be on social media, I would kind of close the book and then check email. And then the time for me to read the book expired, and so I renewed it. And then it expired again. And so that really showed me that I needed to find a way to get through this material because I was actually living the very scenario that it was describing. And you know, as a former journalist, I was also a communications and literature major at UCLA. I love books, I love reading. It was not unusual for me to get through a really good book in just two or three nights. But through going through this particular book, or at least trying to get through it, I really did stop and think, when was the last time that I read a book? I feel like I read a lot. I go on Twitter and I get connected to different articles. I'm getting information from a lot of different places. But you know, to go through a 300, 400 page book, you know, I hadn't done that in a while. And so what I did is I got onto Audible. And I think you guys are probably familiar with Audible. It's basically you have the book read to you, which I always thought was for people who couldn't see, you know, for older individuals that really was easier. My husband does it a lot when he's driving on his commute, but this worked out very well for me. So as I was going out on walks, I was able to get through the material, consume the book, if not read it. And I think it's a sign of the times that I actually had my setting on two times, which is two times faster than the narrator. And so you have, you know, very measured person reading it so people can understand the information, or you set it at 1.5, which is a little bit faster, or you go to two speed, which means that as I'm walking, I'm listening to the information very quickly, and it sounds a lot like I'm talking right now. But that actually worked well, and I was able to get through the material. So the main thing that I want you to take away from this particular book, and I hope this image does it for us, because it really does talk a lot about the brain. And it was a little bit of a biological story, but what I think we can take away from this is that research is finding that the brain is plastic. So let's, you know, kind of if you leave this presentation with anything, think about the fact, what does plastic mean? And Peter, I think, alluded to this. You're creating synapses, and it turns out that the brain is not, we used to think it was like concrete being poured. And I remember hearing about this, you know, early childhood development, the first 3 to 5 years set a child's personality and development. But research now is showing that when there's a traumatic injury, a severed limb, you know, different things that require the brain, over time, over, you know, slow impact and exercise and influence, external or internal, the brain does actually reshape those synapses and is actually affected by those external forces and inward pressures. And so this is really the basis of how we are affected by the technology that we are consuming. So again, plastic brain versus what we used to think, which was pouring the concrete and then it was set. So how are we being affected then with the fact that our communication mediums are changing? The traditional communication for centuries was very calm, it was very linear, it was focused, it was undistracted. It was also very comfortable communication, where we could read a book. You think about somebody who is perhaps reading the newspaper. And that's something where you associate that with, you've got your cup of coffee, you've got your newspaper, you're not worried about some of that coffee spilling onto your mobile device. And that's what we grew accustomed to for a long time. And so that's really the way that our brains were shaped. If you think about how communication works today, you have a lot of multitasking, different devices, different screens. You have families that are connected all the time. So you're connecting in bed, you're connecting all the time while you're driving. This is something that research has showed when you are working in this way, when you have more than anything interruptions, when you're trying to focus on something and you're being interrupted, these short overlapping bursts make for people who are anxious and for people who are irritated. And the most impressive research data that the Shallows showed me was, we may feel like we're getting a lot of information and we are getting smarter, but a lot of research has shown that you might be able to get through the material while you're multitasking or work on several things at the same time, but when you're asked to really interpret what it was that you read or what it was that you were consuming, whether you were listening to it or reading it, it turns out that the comprehension level, cognitive ability, is truly affected. And so what does that mean in terms of the way that we are receiving and disseminating information? And this was the vine for this one, where again, you know, we're laying down, we're very comfortable, and we're very calm. Now, if you think about all of the different communication technologies, language in and of itself, it's something that babies do. And so that's not something that's unnatural. But the act of writing and the act of reading, those are things that have to be taught. And so the earliest cave walls were a form of technology. Maybe those were the early blogs, right? Where people were leaving the information in any way that they could. Exactly, the first wall post. And you really got like the likes, right, with the little hands on there. Then we moved to the printed page. And so then the act of writing was something that had to be learned, and books became a technology. We've seen newspapers come and go. We've obviously seen the evolution of the different phones. And now I think one of the greatest, it's interesting, you know, everybody's concerned newspapers are disappearing, books are disappearing, and there's a whole movement about libraries. What will the libraries of the future look like, or what will the future be like for libraries? In San Diego, where I live, we're just finishing construction of a large city library. We finally got our city library. And now we've got to figure out what to do with it, because our library is still relevant as we see a lot of the bookstores closing. I believe they are, and this is a good article that appeared a few days ago in Inc. magazine, and it's a library in Arizona that is taking a hipster approach to try to make the libraries co-working spaces. And so the space itself has just changed, just like the phone changed from being a rotary dial and then a large one that you hold to what we have today. Libraries as technology mechanisms will change. It will no longer be quiet. You'll hear, obviously, the keystrokes of people working, and it will become more of an open communal space where people meet, gather, and consume information in different ways, but I believe that it will be in collaborative ways. Now, it's interesting because a lot of what the Shallows talked about is that these technologies that are evolving actually make us evolve as well. So when maps were first created, and as they evolved, we actually became explorers and we became conquerors. So you think about societies before they decided to start documenting and organizing what the landscape looked like, their approach to nature and to what was considered nations was obviously very different. The early monks that were inventing clocks, and so of course early on every village had the clock tower to keep time of when it was time to pray. And as this particular technology became smaller, became more personal, as a society we actually became timekeepers. Then we had, the writing ball. It was the first typewriter, and there's an interesting section in the book where the author describes how Nietzsche had these terrible migraines, and so he was used to writing on, the quill and ink, and he would get these terrible headaches, and so he was introduced to this machine where he could actually still write, convey his thoughts, but with his eyes closed. So it was something wonderful for him. But then his friends started reporting back to him, your writing has really changed. It's very structured, it's very cold, it's very rigorous. And he then wrote back to them saying, I felt that was happening. I don't have the warmth and the flow that I feel I used to have with pen and paper. All of a sudden, the machine was helping him to convey his thoughts, but his thoughts were being shaped by the cold machine. So I think that's an early indication of what we're experiencing today. The proliferation of books, especially once the printing presses made books, again, smaller, personal, portable, all of a sudden created a society of readers. It used to be that you had the scribe and somebody would dictate information. It would be written up and there was only one copy in the synagogue or in the church or in the castle. But all of a sudden, books started to become something that people could carry and have for their own. When some of the monks began to read silently, that was a new technology revolution. That was very strange to people of why would you sit down by yourself and silently consume this information? You're supposed to read it aloud, or at least somebody's supposed to read it to you. That's the way it's always been done. And then the same thing when people started writing for themselves, all of a sudden the content and the creativity, if you will, was truly affected, because when you are dictating to somebody what your thoughts are, that's going to be very different than when you sit down and you write about a very strange dream that you have. Or when you sit down to write about some thoughts that are really only intended to be for a very close friend versus the town scribe. So these, again, are ways that different technology mediums are changing us. And as it turns out, the technologies that affect language and communication over time tend to be the ones that really transform society. And books are a good example of that. The book also describes how once word processors were created, we became word processors all ourselves. All of a sudden, we were putting out a lot of information. And I think, I'm certainly old enough to remember typing on a typewriter. And you didn't want to make a mistake because you had to deal with the whiteout and there really wasn't the opportunity to delete and to go back. But once we had these computers that allowed us to do that, and don't you love how big that screen is? We somehow went from that to a big screen and then right back to a small screen again with our mobile devices. Exactly. But all of a sudden, we became a culture putting out a lot more information with the ability to edit it. With the internet era, we're now data processors. That's what the internet is. It's high-speed data processing. But we ourselves are now having to keep track, as a result of the internet, of all the email that comes in, all the instant messages, all the social media, all the different blog posts, not to mention our own work that we have to produce, and now we're doing it more and more on the web. So the interesting thing is, as we are overwhelmed by all of this data coming at us, we turn to technology and to web tools to help us organize it, to help us remember. We become reliant on these tools, which makes us more forgetful, more disorganized. We try to use more technology to try to stay on top of it, and you can see how this actually becomes somewhat of a downward spiral. I mean, as you know, you can interpret that picture, I think, in different ways. And I think the new frontier that we're going to be experiencing now is MMI, man-machine interaction. And so we're starting to obviously consider this through Google Glass. There's been discussion of certainly through e-health initiatives that chips can now be implanted in the body. People who do not have their sight have already had parts of their brain wired up to special glasses so that they can see, and that's awesome. That's wonderful. There are some really great technologies that allow you to keep track of elderly parents. The house technology system in and of itself will keep track of if there's a rapid acceleration, that could mean that the parent has fallen. If they have a special bracelet that's not really moving, that's an indicator for somebody to check on them because they're spending too much time in bed. Something could be wrong. And then, of course, there's the ability to do all sorts of biological testing based on different strips on the body, which, again, are very good things for health purposes, but that starts to get into the way that we are utilizing and really immersing ourselves with technology, and, of course, not just ourselves, but also our children. And it's not really a far stretch. I mean, we already describe our brain very similar to a computer. So we talk about how our brain is wired in certain ways. We talk about, you know, our brain feels fried. But you really start to think about, what does this mean for the earliest generation that is growing up completely with this type of circuitry, if you will. And again, that's an example of how we use this technology to describe ourselves, more of a melding of the human and the machine. And I think, has people here heard about the singularity? Is that a concept? That's kind of a school of thought where there will come a point where we reach the singularity, which means that there is no differentiator between what is machine and what is human. So you can't really tell the difference, whether it's wetware, computer chips that utilize DNA components, and this has been around for a long time. There's fish DNA that was utilized to do an on-off signal. Again, when we think of our own bodies and our own DNA as computer code or our own programming and circuitry, we certainly are moving in that direction, and we're moving at a faster rate than ever. And so it is shaping society. Now, this is an interesting, and I'm a mom of two young boys, and so I experience this on a daily basis. If you've ever seen this video clip, it's got a little toddler, probably no more than 2 years old, if even that, very happy on the iPad. I mean, it's just intuitive to them. You touch it, you expand it, you can see, and then you have the little toddler with a magazine, and that's not so fun. And, you know, it's only 6 seconds on Vine, so you can't see the full video. But basically, the iPad is engaging, and the children will sit there for hours. But when you give them a book, they're tapping, they're trying to open it, and they just kick it aside. Like, oh, this doesn't work. They want something that does work. And so, you know, I think we've probably all experienced the moment where you were doing something not on your computer. Mine was, you know, 10 years ago at least, where I was putting bookshelves up. And then I switched the way that I had them, and my hand instinctively reached to click undo because I liked the way I had it the first time. And that was a moment for me where I thought, whoa, what was that? I'm not on the computer. I'm in my living room. And that was a little strange. I was in a meeting last month looking at some maps for a Parks and Recreation department, and I instinctively reached across the table and tried to expand the map so that I could make it. I couldn't see exactly what the legend said. Kind of pulled my hand back and thought, did anybody see that? Because I just instinctively, you know, it's the way I interact with my iPad, and I was doing that with obviously a printed document. And so, you know, over time, this is just the way, again, that our brains are rewired and that we interpret the physical world in this way. So this is where I think things start to, you know, feel a little bit scary. And I want to say something about that. These were kind of like my bonus ones, but I do want to share this one here. Do you guys remember the movie Limitless? Does anybody see that movie? So the person who invented the vacuum tube, Dr. DeForest, which allowed electricity to be conducted, it was a major breakthrough. But it was interesting how he felt about his own invention. He thought that there would come a time when scientists would be able to electronically measure happiness or fear of human individuals, and he thought that was very scary. Even worse would be if there would ever come a time, and he believed that it would, that professors would download information into their subjects' minds. So if you wanted to learn a language, it could suddenly be downloaded. If you needed to know certain information, there would be electrical conduits into the brain, and you would suddenly possess that information, you know, sort of like the early thinking would be into a machine. And he wrote, thank God that's something for future generations. I shudder at the thought of that day coming. Well, I watched the movie Limitless, and I thought that would be so cool if you could just somehow do something to like have a language downloaded. That doesn't seem very scary to me. That seems like something that would actually be desirable. The early phones, it was thought that housewives were not going to be able to deal with this interrupting bell throughout the day. So they would be cooking and cleaning and tending to the kids. And this invention of bringing this device into the home that was going to be ringing throughout the day was going to make them go neurotic, and the housewives would have to all be sent away to mental institutions because this was just not something that the human body would be able to handle, certainly not somebody as fragile as a housewife. Despite the fact... Exactly. And despite the fact that the kids were crying and then that they were probably multitasking already. But you think about housewives today. And, I talked about something interesting recently with my friends, which was, what's the one thing that if you were to leave the house without, you would not, you know, is it your wedding ring? Is it your wallet? Is it, your ID? And for all of us, it was. What's the one thing you would turn around to go home and get? And it was the phone. If you've ever left your mobile phone at home, you feel a little bit lost without it. All of a sudden, you know, you think about all the different things that the phone, you know, has replaced and represents, and there is your map, and there's your calculator, there's your Rolodex. There is, of course, your phone and your ability to communicate. And so, you know, I really take this to heart, that things that were feared before are things that are actually not just desired, but things that have become indispensable. And I think it's interesting that Dr. DeForest, one of the things that he thought was just going to be too much for people to handle was going to be when we got to a point where we would have something called, he actually called them indispensables. So he thought that there were going to be devices that were going to be electronic devices that would read bedtime stories to the children. And so we would no longer be reading by sight, but we would be listening to information off of these devices that he called indispensables. And he was right. We have our phones now that are indispensable. However, it I don't think is something that we fear. It's just something that we've embraced, and in many ways we're able to connect with more people, with family, and certainly it's something that we're grappling on the significance. So these conversations had been had throughout time. One debate is, you know, is the inventor the judge of the value of the creation that they have invented? And many times they are the ones that understand what they created, so we do leave it to Steve Jobs or Bill Gates. But this particular question of who can judge the actual value comes from the time of Egyptian society. And it was the god Thoth who was discussing the invention of writing. And he was arguing that this was a new technology that was going to destroy society. The other god who invented writing said, no, it's going to be a lot easier to remember things. And the god answered back, no, it's not going to be that people are remembering. It's going to be that they're just regurgitating what they see. So in the end, they won't be creating anything. They will be losing their souls. They will be losing themselves. So that's how far back these debates go. You have Socrates and Plato, and they had a whole discussion. Once written form took hold, then there became a transfer to oral. And I love the image of the early renegades were the poets. Plato was furious that all of a sudden there were these people who invented a new medium, which was not going by the printed and the read word, but just to be reciting. And to me, it seems like, you know, those were the hackers of the day. They were kind of inventing new technologies. And you think about who's on the fringes today. You've got groups like Anonymous and some of the startups that have these crazy ideas. But today, poetry actually seems outdated as we now move into some of these other technologies. I talked about the printing presses, how that really had a revolution. And then we obviously go back to the earliest days. So one of the things, as you think about, you know, technologies come and go, and different things are being replaced. You see here, this is a picture of my kids with one of the startups that I work with called Lockbit. And it really is this desire to have these small technologies. And it is human nature to want to connect. That's how we survive. We did it in the cave days. And it's still something that is in our DNA, it's in our programming, to want to connect with others. And so you can understand why it is this driving force. However, you have to think about, as technology replaces so many different things, you don't want it to replace play for children, or you don't want it to replace actually talking to other people. How do you find that balance? And already, there are different tools that are being replaced, and you see here. Does anybody watch the show Weeds? So this is something that was on the television show Weeds that showed, it was this little glass screen that, you know, would project the light onto the desk, would allow you to type. And, you know, I think the interesting thing about this was a point in the sitcom where marijuana was legalized, and all of a sudden this family that was trying to survive in the suburbs by doing this illicit activity now owned the equivalent of Starbucks. And so, you know, that was how society evolved. It seemed very modern and very clean facility and whatnot, with, of course, the technology that made it seem like, that was the normal suburban experience. But I do think that tends to, as I mentioned, bring a lot of fear into people's minds. Now, as you see that different things are being replaced, you have to think about, hang on one sec, because I want to stop on this one particular one. Okay. So as you see that different things are being replaced, and you have Mayor Bloomberg in New York is replacing all of the payphones with digital screens, and that's a good thing. Why spend money on infrastructure like payphones when you can have giant touch screens that you can touch? It's like having a city representative on every street corner. And obviously, it's better than just having a static sign, because you can project out whatever information is needed. You have to make a service request, you want whatever information. And then you have, of course, the Google Glass. And you're replacing the need to have to find your phone. You're replacing the need to have to reach for your phone. The information is right there. However, are we going to end up replacing eye contact with people? Because you're now walking down the street looking at people that are, quote, with you through the net, and ignoring the people that are actually right next to you. That's something that we already grapple with when we get absorbed into our mobile devices. Exactly. Or to identify them so you can go talk to them. So that remains to be seen. I think that we've seen Twitter there was a time when we thought it was crazy that you would be able to convey, certainly for me as a literature and journalist, how could you possibly convey something in such a small amount of characters, not even words, but characters. But our words now becoming dispensable. So as the technology becomes indispensable, what are the things that are going by the wayside? I found it fascinating that on NPR, there is a new initiative. Have you guys heard about the race card initiative? Where the host actually asks people to describe their entire experience with race in 6 words. So I heard about this and thought, this is ridiculous. This could never work. I basically had the same reaction that I had, I think, when I first heard of Google, of Twitter. But then I actually heard about some of them, and this is one of them. So the 6 words are colored children, African American, progress. So it was an older gentleman explaining that he was born colored, his children are African American. Does that represent progress? And it really was fascinating how in 6 words, there was the ability to have some very poignant thoughts and messages. Word clouds are everywhere, and so I looked up Martin Luther King's famous speech into a word cloud. People today don't listen to speeches, don't have time, even if it's on YouTube. Can you get the same message through a word cloud? Can you get it through an image? It seems like the answer would be no, but then the NPR program surprised me. And yesterday, I was watching Piers Morgan while I was on Twitter. I was reading the Boston mayor's tweets, and I saw that one of the first things that CNN went with was, we got him. That's all it took, 3 words. And it conveyed so much that could have been done in a speech. And then you got 1 word, teamwork. A picture of all of the different agencies celebrating the fact that they work together to keep the citizens safe. And so I do believe that while these things are scary and while they seem like they're impossible, it's not necessarily going to be, I think, as scary and as negative as we might fear. And so I think government agencies have to actually embrace some of this. So how do government agencies embrace this? This was just an example. I don't have to really get into it. But these are, there was, the startup LockBit. They had a screen on the U.S.-Mexico border. I talked about that last year, how QR codes are now something that you can click with. And so we're in the internet now. It's become, a very different type of experience. This particular firm went from the U.S.-Mexico border to actually, again, a 2 25-year-old kids powering the entire PGA Tour in terms of the way that people at that event interact with the screens. They scan the QR code to get the scores. The managers of the event from their mobile phones, it used to be you would call into some data center on-site or maybe off-site, and then they would change. If Tiger Woods was about to come up, you'd want his bio up on the screen. Now it's all being done through the mobile phone as that remote control. And then again, digital screens popping up everywhere, and this is what the new payphones are going to look like in New York, and that's with a company called City 24/7. So what can government agencies do? What do I recommend? I think first and foremost, and I'm going to use the examples of San Diego, where I live. Mayor Sanders was the previous mayor. I remember seeing him at events and seeing his phone and saying, Mr. Mayor, you've got to get a smartphone. And his staff would say, don't even bother. But I loved that Mayor Sanders came to the table to meet the startups, even if he didn't understand all of the terminology. This was when the LockBit guys were explaining to him, now that we're inside the web, our phones become the remote control. That was a year ago, and in that moment, I didn't understand what these kids were talking about. What do you mean I'm in the net? I don't want to be in the net. That seems like I won't be able to get out. But they were very excited about that. And again, the fact that the mayor was at the table listening, and absorbing as much as he could. Now, the next current mayor is Congressman, at the time was Congressman Filner, and he's over on the right. Again, I love that an organization like Startup Circle was able to hold a mayoral forum. And the final 2 people that were running for mayor came, and we did not know if the entrepreneurs and the startups, the initial response was, we don't want anything to do with government. Bring only other startups and venture capitalists to come speak to us. But we really pushed and explained, the mayor is the CEO of our city, and they're going to have initiatives that are going to impact your startup and your entrepreneurial activity. So we went forward with a series, and it actually got some of the highest attendance that we had ever had. So the fact that these candidates were willing to come to the table, take questions, listen to entrepreneurs, and the fact that the entrepreneurs were willing to be there and not just look at government as red tape and bureaucracy, but see them as their leader and hope that their leader would be innovative, I think was a lot of progress. And that's what I would hope to see from other cities. This was a more recent meeting a few weeks ago, again with Mayor Filner. He invited a bunch of startups to come in. They kind of took over City Hall. And as not as a result of this, but as a result of multiple efforts, San Diego announced just last week that they are launching the Office of Civic Imagination and Neighborhood Projects. And so this is something that's very exciting. They really want to work closely with the local startups, the entrepreneurs, the students, and local organizations. And so just like, you know, I just finished not reading Lean In, but listening through Audible to Sheryl Sandberg's book, I believe that government officials need to lean into technology and need to really come to the table. And one of the things when you do come to the table is, you know, I think there's always this fear that you're not going to understand what people are talking about. I certainly feel this when I, again, I'm at the table and I'm hearing people explain that we're in the internet or MMI. I came to a point where I had to say, whoa, excuse me, what exactly does that mean? And it's usually once somebody explains all these terms, you know what it means, you know, man-machine interaction. Okay, I get it, that makes sense. But I think having a curiosity about it, a sense of playfulness. Here you see, I don't know if you can hear it, but the news anchor that was describing the project at the PGA Tour, in reading the teleprompter and saying that, you know, event managers are using their phones as a remote a control, you could tell that she was reading it, but it wasn't quite processing. I think that's always a great sign for emerging technology. And even better is, you know, if the pundits don't quite understand it, but these are my two boys, they got it right away. Mom, give me your phone. They scanned it, and they were playing Pong. So, you know, have that playful attitude where you just get the technology into your hands, visit these tech incubators, and you can see that they're very serious about this. What I love about the startups and the tech incubators is, you know, when I go to one of my corporate clients or one of the cities that I work with, I really can't bring my kids. If I do, it's like, don't touch anything. Let me just tiptoe through and grab what I need. When I go into one of the startups or tech incubators, they stop everything and say, you know, bring these kids over here. Hey kid, you know, try this technology out. What do you think about it? They're really observing how the 5 and 6-year-old engage with that device or engage with that information, and it's very important to them, and they actually really welcome and thank me. Hey, try to bring them in once a week because we're going to be rolling out a new feature, and I want to see how they, you know, and my kids, of course, love it. They want to come, you know, to work with me more often, but there are only certain places that I can take them. So I think this is something that would be wonderful for government agencies to just have a different mindset in that particular way. How am I on time, by the way? Probably like, okay, 5, 10 minutes? Okay. So I think the opposite of having creativity and playfulness is, again, fear and feeling that you have to control the information and not trusting who is getting this information. So San Diego's doing some great things. I mentioned Mayor Filner and Mayor Sanders, and that's the city. But, you know, with our sheriff and police departments, we've had some missteps. And so the City of Poway public information officer, this got coverage, I think it was even in the, you know, national press. She had a moment where she was at the Public Relations Society, at the Society of Professional Journalists, where she explained, you know, just because you're a blogger in your pajamas with your laptop doesn't mean that I should have to answer your questions because you're not a real journalist. The real journalists have been at this a long time and they know what to ask. And so you can imagine how that was received in a room full of bloggers and journalists. And I do understand, I think, where she's coming from. It's a very difficult position. They have limited resources. That's how every government agency is. But it really does take having respect and understanding that if you're putting your information out on Twitter, you suddenly are putting out one piece of information, shorter the better. Go with the Boston mayor's example of just a picture and a few words can suffice, and then you can answer questions on Twitter. You're not having to talk to each individual. So there are ways to be smart about it, and there are ways to be open about it. Then we had another incident where you had a city of San Diego on the boardwalk. You know, there was a gentleman smoking, so he got ticketed, and he filmed the officer while the officer was writing his ticket. All of a sudden, the officer looked up and said, hey, turn that off, you can't film me. The citizen said, yes, I can, I'm allowed to, and I choose not to. The officer said, I'm telling you to turn it off right now, that's a weapon. And the person said, what do you mean it's a weapon? So the officer knocked it out of his hand, arrested him, and the gentleman, you know, went off to jail. The phone cracked, but his friends picked it up and were able to recover the video. Now, last week, of course, we saw that mobile phones can, in fact, be weapons if they're used to detonate a device. At the same time that mobile phones came into play as crucial to finding the individuals that caused harm to so many. And so, you know, it really is a difficult subject to broach. But again, I think if you are having openness, collaboration versus fear and control, that's something that will lead you in a good direction. And then I think finally, you know, who's doing it right? Some of the things in San Diego, Indian Wells is a good example of an app. But more than just an app, the designer that provides their app also has this interesting thing called U-Design, where you create custom t-shirts on the go and they're delivered to your doorstep the very next day. So there are really great technology companies that work with government, but find out what else they're doing. Again, have that curiosity. We have the Voice of San Diego that is putting together open data forums. Hopefully you have these things happening in your city. I learned a lot from TurboTax, where they didn't ask for permission to utilize government information. They just put it out there. The public found it very useful. And now, of course, we have one of the largest corporations in tech using government information. At GovPartner, I was always trained and believed that we don't just put a website out there. We work in partnership with the local governments. We work behind the scenes. And so, you know, there's a lot of disruption in the private sector, but I think it's okay to anticipate some of that disruption within the government industry. This is a good example here of, again, somebody else that's in the nonprofit world all of a sudden looking at donations to nonprofits, not from the standpoint of serving the nonprofits, but from the standpoint of serving people through their Facebook accounts. So if you want to donate to different organizations, you do it through them. They give you a report at the end of the year, and these, you know, non-governmental organizations have to reconcile into that system. Now, they're getting the donations, so that's a good thing, but this is certainly disrupting what they're used to. This is just a picture of a startup class that we put together down in San Diego. And so you can see here, this is, I think, a better picture. So you can see all of these are seventh graders taking notes on their iPads, talking about the startups that they were going to launch. And we really have some great startup mentors and some people. Again, Qualcomm is very involved. They're not exactly a startup in San Diego, and others are. There's a company called Bump. That individual has launched 44 different companies, and it's amazing how he gives of his time. His name is Mitch Thrower. And the advice that he gives to college students above anybody else is learn how to communicate. Worry less about how to use technology, because you guys are down with that. You know how to do instant message and everything, but you don't know how to talk to people. And one city, I'll end with this, that I feel is doing a really great job of talking to its citizens is the city of Carlsbad. Carlsbad is the 50th largest city, I believe, in California, not in the nation. But they have the fourth largest Facebook following. And so they really are following, I think, the advice I can give to local governments. Use a lot of images. That conveys what an entire press release can convey. So invest in that. It actually ends up not being as expensive. And have a conversation with people. Don't just post things and not engage. And we certainly heard that from the Arcadia Police Department. You know, video, everything is visual. So here you can see that on YouTube, Carlsbad has 142,000 video views. And so if you are putting relevant information on there, you can, again, put it out on Twitter, you can put it out on Facebook, but you have to at least create the initial video, and it has to be something that's short and that is actually engaging. Pinterest, we've talked about. If you're, you know, a beautiful coastal community like Carlsbad, it kind of lends itself. But sometimes it's not just about a pretty picture, it's about infographics, and those are hugely important. I think you can use an image and one-word headline to draw somebody in, and then you can have just a quick blog post, no more than a paragraph, or ideally you create an infographic, and that tells you as much information as an entire report would do. Then allow people to click into different data sets and drill all the way down to the open, usable data that they can then take and create apps off of, have their questions answered. And so we're in an era where you may start with just one word or one picture, but that will lead to actually giving out some of your information, open data, so that the public can then run with it. And I think that's it. If anybody has any questions, this is actually on Vine, so just search for Gov20LA, and then you can actually look at some of these, and I hope you comment and let me know what you thought about the information.